Well, good evening. Thank you for coming to the infrastructure session that we have here for Configuration Manager 2012. I'm very happy that you could join us at this late time in the day. My name is Brian Keller. I'm a lead program manager on the Configuration Manager team. You probably don't care at all because you're looking over here and saying, there's Wally. Wally's here. So actually, Wally Mead is here, and he's going to be helping me with the presentation today. I'm actually very honored to have Wally present with me. I've never gotten a chance to present with him before. I've been on the product group for about 8 years. And Wally, you've been on for what, 40, 50 years?
No. Yeah. Thank you, Brian. Let's try 20.
Let's try 20. 20, 20 actually.
I started when I was 2 years old.
But in all that time, neither of us have gotten a chance to present together. So this is awesome. But the real honor is to have you here and to be able to present some of the new features of 2012 and get going on that. What we're going to cover today is talk about infrastructure simplification, the new way that you might think about designing your hierarchy that's different from CMO 7. So we're going to talk a lot about that. We're also going to discuss forest discovery, which is something new. Talk about boundary groups. The other thing I want to go into heavily today is SQL replication, which is the new way that we move data throughout a hierarchy, and we'll go into some details on that. We'll talk about client agent settings and how that is going to be something that will really help you simplify and consolidate your existing hierarchies. Another piece, role-based administration, another way to segment out or logically divide out roles and responsibilities within your hierarchy, which also helps reduce infrastructure. And then as a special treat, I'm very happy to be able to talk about what's going to be coming in SP1 with regards to hierarchy. I wasn't sure I was going to get to talk about that today, but I will get to cover some slides on that. It's pretty exciting. So we had three pillars when we set out to develop Config Manager 2012. The ones we're going to focus on today are unifying the infrastructure and simplifying administration. The empowering users is all about the new app model, and so we have a session on that tomorrow. So modernizing the architecture of Configuration Manager really involved three promises that are three goals we set out to accomplish. The first one was to minimize infrastructure at remote offices. A lot of customers, like yourselves, are probably having secondary sites at each of your branches, trying to control the flow of content. It was pretty unnecessary, we thought, to have that type of heavy infrastructure at the branches, so we made some investments in our distribution points to make that a bit simpler. Also, consolidating the infrastructure for primary sites, making it less necessary to have tiered hierarchies with multiple primary sites to segment out your environment. So we're going to talk later about role-based administration, the client agent settings, how we've added support for language neutral, all those things that help you use less primaries in your environment. So in the future, primaries are going to be about scale out for the most part, being able to scale to 100, 200, 300,000 clients. And then the scalability and data latency improvements is all about bringing in a known system, which is SQL replication, using native SQL services to be able to provide data throughout the hierarchy. So moving away from our classic file-based replication inboxes and all of that. So when you're thinking about your infrastructure decisions, we basically look at the primary major, I shouldn't say primary, that'll be confusing, the major site systems that we're dealing with in a hierarchy. First is the central administration site, which we call the CAS. Then we have primary sites. We have secondary sites and distribution points. So I'm going to walk through each one of these in the new world in CM12. So in CM12, we have a central site. You're going to need a central site for centralized reporting, administration. It's a way to simplify management at one point. We really don't want you to have a central administration site if you don't need one. So when you need a central administration site is when you know you're going to have multiple primaries, which means essentially scaling out beyond 100,000 clients. There's some other reasons that you might have multiple primaries. I'll touch on those in a minute. But for the most part, think about primary sites for scale out. And so if you don't need a central administration site, if you don't need to introduce replication in your environment, then I would suggest not doing that. I'll tell you, I was working with a customer in Germany, and they've really done a good job of consolidating their infrastructure. They had a central reporting site in CMO7. They had about 4 primary sites, 77 secondary sites at each one of their branch locations, a number of remote distribution points. When I visited them, last year, we actually redesigned the hierarchy. They have a primary site, a central site, and about 77 remote distribution points now with bandwidth controls. And I'll talk about some of those improvements in a moment. But the point being that we've taken a lot of server infrastructure out of their environments. Now, I am going to say I'm disappointed that I advised them to have a central site because they really only have 10,000 clients managing, a bit smaller in terms of Config Manager customers. But at the time, I didn't know we had a feature coming in SB1 that allowed you to expand your hierarchy. So I'm going to talk at the very end about this feature. So you want to start with a primary site if you can get away with it. And if you think you're not going to scale out beyond 100,000 clients, you won't need a central administration site. If you're not sure, stick with the primary, because in SB1 we have a feature that allows you to grow your hierarchy from a standalone primary site. So primary sites are really used now in CM12 to manage clients. And those primary sites will report up through the CAS, and they're essentially used for scale out, as I mentioned. You can have some multiple primaries for redundancy. You might have multiple primaries if there's some really pressing political reason that you would need a standalone primary in a remote location, or you know, there may be a reason for it. We're hoping not with some of the new improvements we have around role-based administration. If you have some content regulations where you cannot have certain content travel or replicate throughout your hierarchy, then you may need to lock that down at a primary site for local administrative purposes. What you won't need a primary site for anymore is for decentralized administration. So with role-based administration, you can create users and groups of users that will have roles, and you can assign those roles and scopes and segment out your hierarchy for administrative purposes without having to use physical machines, physical primary sites. Also, we have client agent settings that you can apply to collections. So in the past, you would have to deploy a separate primary if you needed specific settings for clients that reported to that primary. Maybe have all your servers report to one primary, and then you can set some special configurations for those servers. Now we have client agent settings. You can create specialized templates and apply those in your hierarchy to collections. So using collections instead of physical primary sites to do that work. So let's move on to secondary sites. So for secondary sites, you might need those if there's, you know, no local administration required. If you need to, the big piece is that if you need to manage the upward flow of traffic, because our distribution points and the improvements we've made are all about controlling the flow of traffic and content down to the branch. We're still going to send some data up through the management point to the primary from the branch location. Now, your first full inventory might be rather large, but after that, there'll be some deltas. So there's some considerations there. If you need to really strongly manage the upward flow of WAN traffic, if you're worried about it, you're going to put a secondary site out at that location. If you need to do some tiered content routing that's rather complex in your network, then you may need some additional secondary sites. But for the most part, we'd like to see secondary sites, the traditional usage of doing bandwidth controls for content, big pieces of software like Office or other big packages. If you need to just control that flow, you can do that with remote distribution points now. So as I mentioned, finally, distribution points. You put a distribution point out there at your branch location if bits isn't enough to control the WAN traffic. If you don't have branch cache, one of the things we support now is branch cache, so you could have a distribution point that's available at a Windows Server 2008 R2 box, have the branch just clients communicate directly with the primary site, and then have those clients share content with each other. If that's not available, then you want to put a distribution point out at that remote location. If you need Pixie or Multicast for operating system deployment out there, you're going to obviously want a DP. And if you're doing AppV streaming, we would highly suggest you do that from a local distribution point. So let me dive a little bit further into the remote office work that we've done. So first of all, we simplified the deployment and administration of a distribution point. We used to have separate things like a branch DP and it can only run servers and things like that. We don't have a concept of branch DPs anymore. A DP can simply be installed on clients or servers without any issues. We've got the multi-cache option. The big piece that I mentioned was the bandwidth controls that we now put on remote distribution points that allow you to schedule and throttle content distribution. In addition, we have this concept of called pre-staging of content, which means that you can actually take content, extract it out, and move it to that branch location and then import it into the distribution point. And the hierarchy will pick up that the content is there, and you'll just be up and running right away with content. So if you need to potentially have someone drive a USB out to that location, you can have the content all on that USB, plug it in, and import it right into the distribution point. You could FedEx it. If there's some reason where you don't want that traffic going over your slow links, then what you could do is extract it and then import it. We'll go into some more details on that in a little bit. So we have this concept of distribution point groups now. So you take groups of distribution points, you distribute to the group, and content will then go to all the distribution points in that group. And it's a bit state-based, so if you were to add a new distribution point to that group, that distribution point would then get all the content that was assigned to the group. So you can associate these distribution points with collections. So for example, a user collection, when you create a deployment for those users, we can automatically send that content out ahead of time in preparation for a deployment. So I talked a bit about content pre-staging. Let me go into a few more details. So we support all the different package types, applications, software updates, package programs. You can either have your distribution set up for the content library, which is our single instance store, or for the package share. It basically registers those packages with the site server, so once you plug it in and use the tool to import the content, we'll be in good shape there. As I mentioned, this tool called Extract Content can be used to manage multiple or single files that you're trying to import. We also have a conflict detection. So if there's some content already out there and you're importing maybe older applications or older packages, we'll know about that. So it's a pretty neat feature and kind of rounds out, making it very flexible for you to put distribution points at these branch locations without having secondary sites there. So I'm going to hand over to Wally. He's going to talk about Forest and Discovery and Boundaries and do a quick demo for you. Wally.
Thank you, Brian. And I want to offer my welcome to you all, and thanks for hanging in there this late in the day. We understand we're the last thing between you guys and food and drink, so we'll try and get through fairly quickly for you so you can go and partake as necessary. Brian was talking about some of the cool new things we've added into Configuration Manager 2012, and one of those cool new things we've added is the ability of supporting multiple forests. Very commonly, you guys have scenarios today where you have your site infrastructure in one forest, and you have remote forests with clients that you have to manage. And today in 2007, it's a little more complicated to manage those remote forests of clients. You have to have a WINS infrastructure, you may have to have trust relationships set up, you have to have an SLP set up. So it's somewhat a little more daunting as far as your configuration. So one of the cool new things we've added is the ability of managing multiple forests. One of the ways of getting there is through this new discovery method we have called Forest Discovery. By default, when you turn on Forest Discovery, it's going to go ahead and discover your site service forest and any trusted forest of that site service forest. So you automatically know about those forests. What we're going to discover at those forests are the number of domains you have, the number of 80 sites you have, all your IP subnets you have in your environment. Brian mentioned one of his TAP customers. When I was on site with one of my TAP customers, we turned on Forest Discovery, and they discovered 80 sites. No big deal. They didn't know they had that many, but it was no big deal. And when we discovered the IP subnets out of the Active Directory forest, we found 56,343 IP subnets. And they had no idea they had that many subnets in their environment. Now, that was back in beta 1, and we actually couldn't even display all those in our console. We had an issue there, which we've changed how we display those. But what this allows you to do is to save Brian, being the administrator who has to set up this environment, from having to fat finger, or me with one hand, type in the wrong IP subnet as my boundary, or mistype my AD site name as a boundary. Now, we can discover that for you and directly add it in as boundaries if you wishes to. Ooh, having some excitement outside, I think. Rather common around here. What that also allows us to do is you can then take those boundaries and you can add them to boundary groups that we'll talk about a little bit later on, which is dictating what client management scope you have. So that's just letting you find out about some resources to configure your client scope of management. What you can also do, however, is with the Forest Discovery process is you can now have Configuration Manager Site Server publish its site information into those remote forests where your clients are. So think about that. Today in your environment, that means you have to have that WINS infrastructure and SLP because those clients in a remote forest, they can't query your global catalog in your site environment. So they can't find what you have for your MPs and your resources. So you have to have that winds infrastructure and so on. Now you extend the schema for your remote forest just like you do for your site forest, publish our site information there. Your clients can pull their local global catalog to find the information for the site infrastructure. So they can find their MP directly from there. So it's making it a whole lot easier for you to go ahead and add in the support resources for these remote forests. The bottom bullet on there converts all 80 subnet types into supernets. So if you do add IP subnets that we discover through AD Forest Discovery as boundaries, we actually make them into supernets or IP address ranges. In the past, we've had issues with doing the calculation of a 192.168.3.0/22, and we give you the wrong range of addresses. So we fixed that, we made it now, so we're going ahead and putting in the actual IP address range. It'll be accurate for you, make it a lot easier for you to do that management. So the forest and boundary process flow here, we have a forest, contoso.com, with a domain in there, engineeringcontoso.com. We run AD Forest Discovery, and I'll show you how to do that momentarily in the UI. It's going to go ahead and discover our domains, Contoso and the engineering domains. It's going to discover the appropriate subnets we have for those domains, and then any Active Directory sites that have been configured as well. So that's just information we discover. We don't necessarily do anything with it unless you tell us to create boundaries out of those. So we could create boundaries. We could create 5 boundaries out of that information if you wanted, those 3 subnets and the 280 sites. Now what that gives you is the ability of taking that information and using it for boundaries and then using it for boundary groups, which we'll talk about next. And boundary groups is where you really have the power or the utilization of what those boundaries are, whether you manually type them in, which you can still do, and you can still fat finger them if you want to, or you can allow us to find them for you and better security for what you have access to. That last column in that bottom display talks about the purpose of boundary groups. So boundaries in and of themselves in ConfigMan 2012 do nothing for you. They just take up database space and UI space. They are utilized when you add them to a boundary group. A boundary group is a representation, a collection of multiple different boundaries that you want to use for some purpose. So here they show you a boundary group with the appropriate boundary in it. You can have multiple boundaries in a single boundary group. As you can see, Chicago DP has 2 different boundaries there. And then you specify a purpose for the boundary group. The boundary group is either used for site assignment, all clients in these boundaries are assigned to this site, or they're used for content lookup. So the stuff Brian was just talking about with the DPs. Here are the distribution points that clients in this boundary group have access to. Somewhat analogous to you creating protected DPs in ConfigMan 2007. And then you see the second one on the list, Hawaii, it's using the same boundary group for both site assignment and content lookup, which you can do as well. So boundaries, you have the same 4 type of boundaries, AD sites, IP address ranges, IP subnets, and IPv6 prefixes. Those remain the same. The difference is that we don't use those boundaries you create until you put them in a boundary group. And then with the boundary group, you specify whether the content lookup or site assignment or both. And then you go ahead and utilize those for the appropriate resources. The cool thing is that you guys all know we don't support overlapping boundaries for site assignment. That causes really bad things in Configuration Manager. And it does the same thing in 2012, causes really bad things. However, because you can separate boundary groups by purpose, Brian can create a boundary group for his distribution points that does have overlapping boundaries. Because he doesn't care, he just wants to make sure clients find the content on a DP somewhere. I manage the client deployment, and I want to make sure that my clients get assigned to the right site. So I won't use the same boundary group that Brian's using with multiple boundaries that are overlapping in it for content lookup. I'll create my own boundary group with a very restricted IP subnet or AD site, whatever's appropriate for me, boundary, and label that one for site assignment. So you can have separate boundary groups for site assignment, non-overlapping, versus content lookup, which are overlapping. So it gives you that flexibility in how you want to utilize those resources. When you do a migration that Brian and I will talk about tomorrow morning, we can convert your boundaries from ConfigMan 2007 over to boundaries in ConfigMan 2012 and create appropriate boundary groups for content lookup as well as for assignment if you choose to do that. So let's go ahead and do a quick little demo. Okay, so here we have our administration workspace for the central administration site, which Brian already talked about. So if you go to the administration workspace from the console, first thing I'll just show you is what got discovered. So if we go to hierarchy configuration, here's Active Directory Forest, and you can see we discovered a forest. If you look down below, It gives you some information about that for us. Ignore the formatting here, this really squished columns there. It's just because of the screen resolution we have here. You guys and your big monitors, you won't have that problem. But what we discovered was this one domain. So we show you all the domains we'd have discovered, when we did the discovery, and whether it's successful or failed, and if we're configured to publish to that forest, which obviously we are configured to publish for these different sites. Now, if I want to also see what IP subnets got discovered, I go to that forest. I then on the ribbon say show IP subnets. There's the IP subnets that got discovered, including the offset on that. I can also go and see the AD sites and see that information. By default, we'll just create the boundaries out of that information if you turn that on. How you turn that on is from discovery, Active Directory Forest Discovery, and you see we have it enabled at the CAS, not at either of the primary sites. You don't have to do this at one location. Go to the properties, and you see enable it, and state whether or not you want to create boundaries out of the 80 sites we discover and or boundaries out of the IP subnets that we discover. Turn those on, let it run. When we run, we create this information you see down below. If you do have us create boundaries, then you go to the boundaries node, and there's your boundaries. There's the IP address range that we discovered. There's the two Active Directory sites that were discovered. So you have those that are discovered for you automatically. You want to put them in boundary groups for use? Go to boundary groups, create a boundary group, specify what boundaries you want to have in that boundary group. Then how do I want to use that boundary group? References, site assignments up here at the top. Any clients in this boundary group is going to be assigned to one of these sites. And the reason we show you secondary sites, you can't assign clients to a secondary site, but that's used for client push. You can now push clients from a secondary site, management point, distribution point, a lot easier than you can do today. And then if you want content lookup for Brian's distribution points, that's down at the bottom. I just add the DPs in here that my clients can use that are members of this boundary group. And the last thing I'll show you there is if I want to add a remote forest for clients, go to back to Active Directory Forest, add forest, and I type in the forest name. Brian's Forest, and then I specify if I have to have a different account to utilize to discover it from that forest. Maybe my site server computer account won't work because we're in an untrusted scenario. So I can go ahead and designate an account that would have rights to read Brian's Forest. And then I specify whether or not I want to publish. What site do I want to publish in that remote forest? So very, very simple, and it gives you that flexibility and easier management of your clients in those remote forest scenarios. All righty, with that, I think I kick it back over to Brian.
Definitely.
Yep, there you go.
All right, thanks. Thanks, Wally. So let's take a moment to talk a little bit about the SQL replication in Config Manager 2012. It's the new way that we move data throughout the hierarchy. One of the goals we had was that your interactions with the DBA that you would normally have in CMO 7 are very consistent with the interactions you have in CM 12. So you think, well, they're moving to SQL replication, I got to learn SQL, I have to have all this new specialized knowledge. One of our big goals was to make sure there was enough information for monitoring, for troubleshooting within our console to provide you a good look at replication and solving problems on your own without going into SQL. So we're hoping you won't have to go into SQL any more than you do today in CMO 7. That was a big goal for us and went after it. So as I mentioned, there's a lot of monitoring, troubleshooting. There's some tools I'll show you in a little bit that allow you to do a lot of the analysis within our console and not in SQL. We have a system that's called DRS, Data Replication Service. It's a configuration manager built solution. It comes out of our product group, but it takes advantage of some standard SQL technologies, which is the service broker and the change tracking features. So the data is encrypted. It's one way, bidirectional, and it runs under the SMS exec service. So in a moment, I'll show you a demo where I shut that service down and we'll have some problems with the application. We'll have to go try and fix it. So we have three types of data that we replicate throughout the hierarchy. The first is global data. And global data are things like collections, applications, packages, programs, software updates, the information about those objects are all replicated globally, which means if you create them at the CAS, then they will move throughout the hierarchy. Each primary site will have information about those objects. So the central administration site, the primary site, and the secondary sites also get information replicated to their SQL database as well, although it's a subset of the overall global data. But important pieces are sent to the secondaries as well. The next type of data we have is site data. Site data is very specific, think to the clients and the primary sites. So that site data obviously makes its way to the central administration site. Everything rolls up there. And site data resides at the originating primary site. So think about things like hardware inventory. Think about the actual devices and users and collections, alert messages specific to that primary site. We're not sending all of that information around to each primary. So, you know, the parent knows about the children and all of its data, but the children don't know much about each other in the sense of that inventory information. So if you go to a primary site, you look at it, and you're looking at Resource Explorer, you're looking at inventory information, you're looking at some information around reports for those specific clients that are reporting to that site, that's all that you'll see. You won't see things from other primary sites. And then the third type of content, or third type of data we have is content. Content uses it's file-based replication. It doesn't actually go into SQL and travel around. So when you're thinking about creating a package, sending that throughout your hierarchy, it's a file-based replication system. So it goes to the primary site, secondary sites, distribution points is where content will reside, and that uses the file replication. So here's a little bit of an eye chart I put together. I tried to use some colors to make it easier for you. But in essence, this emphasizes what I was talking about just a moment ago with a picture. So the global data makes its way to the central administration site, to the primaries, down to the secondaries, and it replicates throughout the hierarchy. So as I mentioned, package programs, applications, collections, the actual metadata around collections, not the membership, that all travels throughout the hierarchy, and that's the orange line that you see there. Site data is sent up to the central administration site, but not across to the primaries or to the secondaries, and then content is available wherever you deploy it. So I wanted to talk for a second about maintenance modes because, you know, this is mostly just a slide for reference, but you will encounter maintenance modes upon occasion, so I want to make sure you're familiar with what that is. So we have something called a site maintenance mode, which happens on primary sites and secondary sites. And all the SMS components, except those required for replication, are shut down. Think about times when you're adding a new primary to your hierarchy, or potentially when you're upgrading to SP1 or some future version. We're going to need to be able to shut down certain parts of replication until that primary site has the data it needs and is up and running and ready to go, initialized, as we call it. We have a replication maintenance mode that happens on the central site while an attach is happening, for example. So if you're in site maintenance mode, you're automatically in replication maintenance mode, but the reverse is not true. And I think the next slide kind of outlines when you would find yourself in these situations. So when you have a CAS and you're attaching a primary to the CAS is going to be in replication maintenance mode. It's still going to get data from other primaries. It's still going to be able to be used for central administration, but there's going to be some stuff missing until that primary site's initialized and we can start up the services again. A primary goes into site maintenance mode when it's attaching to a CAS, so the primary is not usable during that time. But once the global replication is complete to that primary, it'll be up and running again. A secondary goes into site maintenance mode when it's attached to a primary site. And then a CAS with no primary sites at all, when you're first kind of setting up your hierarchy, that CAS is going to be in a maintenance mode where it's not really doing anything, not replicating. So let's talk a little bit about what I mentioned a moment ago, which is the monitoring and troubleshooting for replication. There's a number of areas you can go to find out information about replication. I'd sure like to keep you in the UI if possible. So that's the primary way that you'll look at replication, manage it, monitor the link status, and so forth. You've got some status messages for the RCM component and HMAN that will tell you if things are working or healthy, so you can look at those. We've got log files. Hate to send you the log, but you might have to go there, but I hope not. Hopefully the monitoring within the admin console will be enough. We actually have a stored procedure that you can run, which is a diagnostics stored procedure for the DRS component. And so you can run that and get a view of all the replication. You may have to run that upon occasion or work with your SQL DBA to do that. Once again, keeping the UI if possible. We've got the vlogs that has the BCP and SQL errors. And then another thing you can do is you can run our replication link analyzer, and I'll show you a demo of that in a little bit. But I would consider that a UI tool for managing and monitoring replication. So when you're in the admin console, some of the things you want to look for are the active status for links, so the link status, which is in monitoring. If they're not active, then we may have a replication issue. Maybe there's an initialization problem, could be degraded. So you want to look at those link states. That's a first foremost where you want to go. You're going to want to look at statuses. And then after that, when you're looking at the, after you're done looking at the link status, go into the replication link analyzer, run that, and it can tell you about issues and actually automatically remediate certain things that we know are common problems. So in the UI, that's where I'd like to keep you. A little bit more about this replication link analyzer. Have you ever, obviously a lot of us have probably run into this. You have a problem with your network and you run the network diagnostics wizard like in Windows 7 and it says, hey, I'm going to reset your adapter and I'm going to try some things. I'm checking to see if there's a problem with DNS. And so we've modeled the replication link analyzer after that UI. So it's the same thing. You run the analyzer, it's detecting issues, it's trying to fix them for you. You can skip and move to the next. Those types of things are all available in the RLA. So it's very similar to that Windows 7 network troubleshooting tool experience.
But works better.
But it works better.
Yeah. Okay.
I found that the network troubleshooter actually helps me most of the time because I just have very simple problems that I can't deal with. So anyway, let me dive into the console now, a demo, and show you some of the stuff I was just talking about. So as I mentioned, one of the first things I want to go do is land in the monitoring node, and I can look at the database replication piece. So you see I've got some problems with my hierarchy. First of all, I do have a link that's active and healthy. That's from the CAS to primary site 1. Also, I have a primary site 2 that's up and running, but we got an issue. I actually created that issue. So we'll go and look and see how we might be able to fix that. In addition, I've got an issue with primary site 1 to secondary site. I simply didn't start that VM. So that machine is basically offline. And so that's why we're seeing that issue there. So one of the things I want to do is when I'm looking at these links is I want to set up some alerts. So if I right-click and look at link properties, I can always set some alerts about how often or for a period of time I'll generate an alert which the replication link is down. So in this case, if the replication is not seen to be healthy for about 30 minutes, I'll generate an alert and provide that in the console. You can do it more often or less often as you please. So alerts would show up here in the home page. I've got this replication link connectivity down, so there's an alert there. I have a few of those. So that's something that you'd see. I believe you'd also get to see that at in your alerts dashboard here. So I've got some issues. That connectivity's down. I've got some compliance issues. Well, I've got to get the software updates guys on that. And then I have this warning here, which is that there's not enough free disk space on primary site 1. So one thing I did was that I set up an alert, and I'll go into there in just a minute, that says if there's less than 100 gigabytes of free disk space on a particular SQL server, go ahead and send me an alert. How I would set that up is to go to administration, go to the sites, primary site 1, I believe it was. And there's an alerts tab here. And I went ahead and increased this. By default, I believe it's 10 gigabytes. So I increased it to 100 for the purposes of this demo. So going back in, that's how I would see alerts and set alerts for common issues. So another view that I can take is to go into the site hierarchy view. And this is pretty neat. So right now, with the site hierarchy view, I can see I have a CAS, I have a primary 1 and a primary 2. I do have in this hierarchy a secondary site, but as I mentioned, I did not launch that machine, and so obviously we have an issue with replication because it's not happening. That warning around the disk space, that's represented by this warning and this yellow. And the problem I have with replication is right here, represented by this dotted line. So it's another view I can take of my hierarchy to go ahead and understand when there's some issues. So let me go ahead and take care of this replication issue using the replication link analyzer, RLA, as we affectionately call it with our acronyms we use all the time. So let's go in and back to the database replication. You'll see here I have the replication link analyzer. I can also right click and launch that as well. Go ahead and fire that off, and it's going to reach out to that primary site and do an analysis and provide some information back to me. So it found the problem pretty quickly. This is a pretty big issue, and it's something that is checked fairly early in the RLA analysis. It says, okay, your SMS executive is not running. And since that's the primary service that drives replication, that's a problem. So one of the things I could do is I could skip it, go in, maybe look at the machine and see, you know, what happened. I don't understand. I can actually go in here and go into that primary 2 and look at the services, and I can see, yeah, shoot, that's not running. Maybe I'll manually start it, or maybe I'm going to talk to somebody. Why would that shut down? Did something go wrong? So I can look at this further. So I could do that manually, or I could simply have the RLA tool go ahead and try to auto-remediate that for me. So I'm going to go ahead and give that a shot here. So once again, the RLA, the replication link analyzer on the CAS, is going and reaching out and restarting the SMS executive service, hopefully. Continue, it's going to look at some other things. We have a whole rule set. It's basically a definition, an XML definition file that we can update potentially and add new rules to. So the rule engine is pretty extensible the way we've designed it. Here I've got a fairly big backlog. I'm not going to mess with that now. This has been down for quite a while. So I'm going to go ahead and skip that rule, and it'll just continue to kind of look at some issues. It did notice that I've got some empty tables here. I'm not using AppV inventory. I don't have the virtualization client running and sending hardware inventory for that. So it's saying, hey, you know, I've got some tables here that maybe they need to be initialized because there's a bunch of empty data, some stuff missing. I'm going to go ahead and just cancel out. I want to verify that on primary 2, the service was remotely started. Let's see if we refresh this. Where can we do that? We'll refresh. And it was started, up and running. So cool, remote fixing. That's pretty neat, huh? I think it's pretty cool. Yeah, applause is good. I know it's 5 o'clock, or now it's almost 5:30. Pretty neat stuff. So it's going to take about 10 or 15 minutes before the link status is updated to active and healthy. So that's just kind of the latency we have with the system sending information. So it's about 10, 15 minutes. So we'll go back maybe in a little bit and see that it's active. But anyway, we know the problem solved. We used RLA. That's pretty neat. So back to that site hierarchy diagram. I want to show you something that I think is pretty cool. I don't know how valuable it is. Maybe we'll, you can give me some feedback after the presentation, or you know, but I think it's pretty neat, is this geographical view of your hierarchy. It actually uses Bing Maps. And so you can see here, this is total crap because these are all sitting on this laptop here on the stage. But the cool thing is you get to set the locations, and you can use addresses, city names, all that kind of stuff. I'll show you how to do that in a second. But so in my fictitious world, our CAS is in Orlando. That's true. I've got the primary 1 in Miami, which I thought was neat, although I think the first game of the NBA Finals is in Oklahoma City. I'm from Seattle. I really don't want to talk about this finals, but I'm really torn. So we've got Orlando, we've got Miami, and then just, you know, taste of home, I put the other one over here in Seattle, Washington. So I can go ahead and click on these guys, and I can see kind of the communication channels, the links. If I zoom in, I'm going to have some state information here. If I hover these guys, let me make them a little bigger. I can hover primary 1. That's that warning around the disk space. So I can also do some lightweight monitoring through this view, the geographical view, using Bing Maps. Now I have to remember how I can set these guys. I did a little while ago. I think you go configure view settings, right, and then you go into site location. You can see where I've added a string here, Orlando, Florida, Miami, Seattle. Now this would be anything that you could enter into the search bar of Bing Maps and get a location. So it could be an address. It could be like McDonald's Seattle, if it could find one that was, you know, unique. I don't know. You can anything that you can plug into the Big Maps search, wherever it resolves, that's where it's going to show your sites. So that way you can have and if you have a very complex hierarchy, you can see, you know, all around the world where your different site systems are. So I think that's pretty neat. I'm trying to think if there's anything else I wanted to show you regarding that. That is about it. So I'm going to go ahead and get out of this. Back to the presentation. And I'm going to hand off to Wally to talk about client settings. So here you go, Wally.
All right. Thank you, Brian. And from what I'm hearing outside, we don't have to worry about it ending early.
Well, you know,
can make sure we can go late because you guys don't want to go outside anyway with what I'm hearing.
Well, for a minute there, I was sitting over here. I thought, am I breathing into the mic? And so I'm holding my breath, and I'm like, if I keep holding my breath, though, I'm going to get up here and not be able to do the demo, and it's going to be terrible. So I don't. It's not me.
There's something going on out there. It definitely is not you. So that's why I'm surprised people are walking out, because they're going to be walking out into a thunderstorm. So they must have someplace else better to go inside. Anyway, so one of the reasons Brian was, when he's talking about reduction of primary sites, that you guys have a bunch of primary sites out there, and we want you guys to reduce them as much as possible, getting down, if possible, down to a single primary site. Now, we all know that you have to have multiple primary sites. But in that slide, one of the reasons he had listed for being able to reduce number of primary sites is because of client settings. So today, if Brian manages the server infrastructure and I manage the desktop infrastructure, and I need to have inventory done on a daily basis because my hardware changes all the time on my workstations. But he manages the servers. His server hardware is not changing very frequently at all. He only wants to do hardware inventory every 2 weeks. Well, your site settings, your hardware inventory agent configuration in ConfigMan 2007, it's all clients in that site. So if my server, his servers and my desktops are in the same site, we're going to get the same settings. Now, we all know you can use the SDK and you can create a local policy that would change one of our schedules. But most people don't do that. Because most people like me, they can't even spell API, let alone use one. So you would go ahead and create a separate primary site. So Brian would have a site for his servers, and I would have a site for my desktops, and we'd have a central site above to get consolidated information and reporting. Well, in 2012, you no longer have to do that. And Brian will talk about role-based administration later on. Another big reason you don't have to do that, have multiple primary sites for separating your servers from your desktops. So one of the cool things we've added is the client settings. The ability of having client settings that, by default, are hierarchy-wide. So all of my clients had the exact same settings. So today, you guys struggle with that as well, because you want all your sites to be the same, and your rogue admins down at the child sites, they go change their settings. So you guys have to use the transfer site settings wizard and have it distribute that through software distribution on a periodic basis and reset those settings. Now, everything's global by default, so it's all clients in my hierarchy look the exact same way. But Brian wants different settings than I want for his servers than I want for my desktops. So you have the ability of creating custom client settings that change whatever values you want to, that you can then assign to a collection of clients. So we'll set the corporate standard to daily hardware inventory, because we have a majority of workstations. And then for Brian, who wants every 2 weeks hardware inventory, we'll create a custom client setting, hardware inventory set to 2 weeks. We'll assign that custom setting to his collection of his servers. That will then override the default client settings that are set globally for the entire infrastructure. You can create as many custom settings as you want to. There are device-based settings, which is the majority you'll create, so clients. There's also some user-based settings, things that users can do that would override your site defaults in some cases. For example, enrolling devices or remote wiping or being able to opt their computer out of power management through Configuration Manager. So a few things like that. But for the most part, you're looking at device-based settings. So changing your inventory agents configuration or remote control settings, or whatever they happen to be. So that's a real big key there. And we have this priority-based system so that I have a default setting. Brian creates his hardware inventory settings for his servers, assigns that. That will take priority or override the default settings. And we have this priority system that if my computer's in multiple collections and those multiple collections have different client settings applied to them, which one is going to win out? And we have this priority-based system, very much like group policy, and you have a resultant set of policies based. Same type of scenario with us. We'll go by priority and we'll implement the highest priority setting, then we'll fall back to the next lowest priority setting, then all the way down to the default settings would be the last ones. Actually, they're applied first, and then the higher priority ones get applied later on. If you want to see what your resultant set of policies is for client settings, in the Configuration Manager 2012 toolkit, which is up on the website, you can download, the Policy Spy tool has been updated to show you what that resultant set in policies for our client settings is. So you can go and see what really is being applied to your clients. So in 2007, which you guys have today, you would create different primary sites to have different settings. Again, you could use local policies in the SDK, but most people don't do that. And then it affects your clients locally at that site. And so it's all based around site configuration. If you want global configuration, again, it's the Transfer Site Settings Wizard to go ahead and configure those and replicate those out. In ConfigMan 2012, Brian already mentioned global data, replicates everywhere. So no matter what site I create a custom client setting at, it replicates everywhere. Or if no matter what site I configure my default client settings, it replicates the entire infrastructure, so all sites have the same configuration. Now we create our custom settings at any site. They replicate up to the CAS, down to my sibling primary site, but they can implement it on any collections we want that are appropriate. So it's global-based data, and it's global administration that you're implementing and working through, just like we really want you to have with that central administration site and global data administration. Now, another key thing that we have is the hardware inventory configuration. How many of you like to edit the SMS DefMoff in Notepad? There's a few hands. I'm a Notepad expert as well. I like it, but most people don't. It's not that fun. I'm probably the only one old enough in here, but any of you old enough to remember the old Mothman tool from SMS 2.0 toolkit? And there's a few of you, good. Wow. So everybody liked that. That was a GUI interface to modify your SMS DefMoff file. And then when we came out with SMS 2003, our MOF got too big, it couldn't fit in that Mothman tool anymore, and we never bothered updating it, so it was back to using Notepad. When I first started, it was Edlin, modifying this thing. Way back when, some of you children probably never heard of Edlin, so it went over some of your heads. Well, now we want to get away from that physical file for a number of reasons. One is the editing, another one is the processing of that file, and you had to have, in a hierarchy, it was really best to have a consistent SMS DefMoff hierarchy. Otherwise, you had data issues when data got forwarded up from child primary sites and processing it and so on. It could throw data loader from multi-threaded into single-threaded mode. So we really recommended a single SMS DefMoff per hierarchy. Now we've gotten rid of the file. That file no longer exists. You can't go and edit the SMS DefMoff file in Notepad or Edlin or Word or whatever you want to use, your editor of choice. That file has physically gone away. We've now replaced it with this user interface. So we have a user interface that is very, very easy for you to go and modify the classes and attributes you want to report on. And it's backwards compatible to your existing MOF file. So you guys already have a large investment in your hardware inventory today with your SMS DefMoff files in your 2007 environments. When you migrate over to 2012, which Brian and I'll talk about tomorrow morning, you can import your SMS DefMoff file from ConfigMan 2007 into the definition here in the UI into 2012, and then get rid of the file. You got to keep it for 2007, but we won't use it anymore here. And it's all database driven now. So very, very cool for you. So how this works is you create your client settings to figure out your inventory classes. So I'll create my default settings. You can see both sites for servers and desktop or laptops had the exact same reporting classes. So your default client setting will have the classes you want every single client to report. So your standards for your entire organization. Then what you'll do, Brian will on his server side, he'll enable the reporting of additional classes that make sense for him. He needs to have services, he wants the NT event log. On my desktops or my laptops, I want battery, I want PCMCIA adapter. So different inventory information is being customized through custom client settings, but the default stuff we want everybody to report goes in your default client settings configuration. And then you go ahead and apply those appropriate settings to your clients, which is what I'll show you right now. When I press the right button. There we go. And yes, the first game is in Oklahoma City.
All right. Yeah. You can leave Florida now and head off to client agent setting world.
Yep. That goes away. Bye-bye, Florida. All righty. So here is our client. Let me scroll up there, get some more real estate for you. I'll collapse that. And then here's our default client settings. So we have three created here. One's default. As you can see, it says default on it. And then we have two custom device settings. So if we go to default client settings and go to properties, here is where you would see in the ConfigMAN 2007 environment, if I just cancel this guy back out, this is where you'd see all your hardware, your agents, hardware inventory agent, software metering client agent, advertised programs client agent, remote control, and so on. You see all 10 of those different client agents here, and you go configure them individually. Now you do that through the default client settings. And so all of your agents are over here on the left-hand navigation pane. So you pick the agent you want to configure. If you want to turn on software distribution, there's software deployment. And you go ahead and configure how often you want to do your evaluation. If you want power management turned on, here's power management. So you just click on the node, you configure the appropriate options you want, but it's all in one GUI interface. Now, specifically for what we were talking about for hardware inventory, here's the hardware inventory. Here's my schedule, it's enabled. Do I want to be able to collect MIF files or not? But here's these set classes. So here's your SMS defmoth file in GUI interface. So again, if you go search your hard drive on your 2012 site servers, you won't find SMS underscore defmoth. That's gone. So here's the default classes that are enabled. If I want to enable an additional attribute, let's say battery, I just expand, pick the appropriate option that I want, and bingo, it has now been added to the definition for hardware inventory. Now, if what I want's not there in the defaults, it's very easy to go click the Add button. And now you can go ahead and browse to a WMI namespace. So I click Connect. I can connect to a remote computer. Maybe my site server doesn't have that namespace locally, but I could browse out to Brian's server that has the namespace with the information you want to collect for his servers. He can browse out to a remote computer if he wants to. You specify the namespace you want. I'll just go to the default of root SIM v2. If you need to, you can specify credentials to be utilizing across the network. I'll click Connect. There's the root / SIM v2 class on the central administration site server called Central. I then go ahead again and pick whatever appropriate class I want. And bingo, it then adds that to my SMS defmoth. Now, if this gets kind of complicated and long for you to go and cruise through here, you can do searching. So our core organization, we want to use webcams now for a new conferencing solution that we have. So I need to see if there's a webcam solution here. I can just type in cam. It'll go ahead and search and find my mobile device camera. So I can go ahead and implement that and add that into my category as well. So I have all these different options there that I can go ahead and do. Last thing is if I want to import, I go ahead and click import, and I can browse to the SMS defmoth file that I've created for my 2007 environment. Or maybe right now Brian has an entirely different primary site than I have. We're in different infrastructures. He's created one. He wants to then move over to mine from 2012 to 2012. You can browse to it. Or if I want to export one, I go ahead and export mine, and it'll save it out into a MOF file format that I can then import to a different site or save it for recovery purposes as necessary. So that's very, very cool. So you can go ahead and create whatever settings you want to there for hardware inventory. Now, our next scenario is we want to do remote control. So remote controls are configuration that we want to implement. So we went ahead and created a custom remote control setting for workstations. Let's just go ahead and look at the properties of it real quick. And you see you just select remote control, give it a name, and you configure the settings you want. And we enable it. One of the cool things is now with 2012, when you enable remote control, we can open up the firewall ports for you. That was the biggest problem our customers had in 2007 and earlier releases. They turned on remote control, but they hadn't opened the firewall. They hadn't opened up the TCP 2701 port. So remote control would always fail. Now you just tell us, hey, yeah, config that, and you go open up the port for me. So we got it enabled.
Yeah.
I coded that one myself. No. I already told you I can't spell API. And you configure whatever you want for your parameters. So here you can see the default for set viewers is nobody. So local administrators can do remote control. So that's fine for our scenario for our workstations. But we have a set of executives. Executives have their computers, and they want to limit who could remotely control the executive workstations. So we're going to go ahead and create a custom device setting. And we'll type exec remote control as well as I can here. So if there's typos, ignore the typos. I'm limited here on my abilities. Not just because of my hand, because this is a lousy keyboard, and I don't type well anyway. So you guys don't know that, though. I just told you.
What's really impressive is he's learned how to use the mouse left-handed, which I could never do. He did it in like 3 days. It's amazing.
What that tells you is I've had a lot of problems with my right hand before, unfortunately. So anyway, so I select remote tools as an option I want to change. I click on remote tools. All the settings are the way they are in the default configuration. But what I want to change is permitted viewers. So I'm going to go ahead and add some permitted viewers in here to limit who can access these appropriate computers. Well, some of you guys are really good at typing. You've already noticed me. I'm not very good at typing. So I don't want to have to fat finger the appropriate administrator here. So we'll go ahead and browse Active Directory. So we'll go ahead and browse and Meg. And we found Meg as an administrator. Click that, puts in the appropriate account information, adds it to our remote control settings as a permitted viewer. We had that set for one viewer. All right, we go ahead and save that out. Now what I would do is I'd go ahead and deploy this to a collection of computers. So I would go ahead and do a deploy, and then go to my device systems. I would go to my server systems collection and deploy that out. And now when they retrieve policies, this setting will take priority over other settings, the defaults. But uh-oh, look at exec remote control is a lower priority than workstation remote control. That means it's going to be permitted viewers, nobody, or blank. So what I want to do is I want to change priority. So I'm going to take exec remote control. I'll do an increase priority. So that'll bump him up from a 3 to a 2. The lower the number, the higher the priority. So if I want to make sure this gets all the way up there, I can go ahead and bump him up again. So make sure he's the top configuration. So now he's going to be the last one implemented. We'll make sure I have the appropriate remote control viewers implemented on my environment. So now Meg will be the only one that is allowed to remotely control the executive desktops or whoever's been deployed to in that appropriate collection. And you can deploy to multiple collections if you want to. You can always go back and see what your deployments look like, server systems as opposed to executive desktops. But anyway, you get the point. So this feature allows you to reduce the number of primary sites by allowing you to create custom settings, override your default settings, assign them to collections of systems to control how you want things set. With that, I'll hand it back over to Mr. Brian for role-based administration.
All right, thanks, Wally. So Wally talked about client agent settings. That's the first kind of punch in being able to simplify your infrastructure. The second big punch is role-based administration. So being able to segment out your hierarchy based on users and the roles and the objects that they would go ahead and administer within your organization. So you can map organizational roles of administrators to these security roles that we have. And it's a hierarchy-wide security system. So role-based administration, RBA, I think in some of the earlier builds or documentation, we said RBAC, role-based access control, so you may have heard that. But this is the security system for Configuration Manager, for admins logging in and being able to perform tasks. We tend to call this the show me feature because what happens is as an administrator who's maybe segmented off to just do help desk tasks, maybe I only can look at certain collections and launch Resource Explorer, but I can't deploy software updates and applications and muck with the administrative pieces like site systems and so forth. I'm going to log into the console. I'm only going to see those things relevant to me. Show me what's relevant to me. Declutter the console, and that's how it is when you log in. So the administrative segmentation is done with the big three, I guess. And I'm not talking about Bosch and LeBron and Wade, okay? Sorry, I got the finals on my mind. So the big three for role-based administration are the security roles, the security scopes, and the collection. So a role is a bundling of permissions. We have an application manager role, a software updates manager role, potential remote control role. You can create some of your own roles. So we have roles that have permissions associated with them that enable you to perform certain tasks or actions within the console. Then we have what are called security scopes. And you can assign those scopes to objects. Like maybe each application of this type is assigned to a specific scope. Like maybe all the applications in my French subsidiary, those are the French apps, and I'm going to assign a security role of France to those. And so I can assign those security scopes to a user when I assign them a role. And then the third big one in the big three are the collections. So being able to scope out collections that administrators can go in and do things with. They can deploy software to those collections. If I'm the French admin, I can deploy software that's only made for France to collections of French machines, et cetera, et cetera. So you kind of get the point. Those are the three big things, the roles, the scopes, and the collections. So in 2007, what it looked like is if you had the France primary site, then you'd have to have an English primary site because you want Louis, the French admin, to be able to only manipulate things and manage things, both for client agent settings, but also for deployments and activities, software updates at the French site. So you got a primary site for that. And then you had Anthony in England, and he would have a primary site that he would use to control his access to different objects at the English site. Meg would create and distribute a package, and then from there, Louis and Anthony would take it. What we have now in 2012 is Meg at the central site still creates the package, potentially creates the app, but then that app and the content is distributed out to all the places where it's supposed to go, and then Meg goes away and Louis logs in and then can deploy that app to the collections that he has rights to and to the objects that are scoped for just him, for his security scope. And then along comes Anthony, and he can do the same thing for the English collections. So let's talk a little bit about collection limiting. So everything is, so in this case, Meg gives Louis permission to French systems, which is collection limited to all systems. So all systems is a built-in collection. Now, what Louis can do is he can read the French systems collection, and he can read anything that's limited to the French systems collection. So if there's a French desktops collection, Louis can then view that. But Louis can also go ahead and delete that, modify the query, even add additional collections underneath French systems like French servers. But what Louis can't do is he can't manipulate the collection that his role is assigned to. So that belongs to Meg. But anything below that, Louis has the rights to manipulate. So every collection in CM12 is limited by another, except for those two root collections I mentioned, which is the all systems and the all users and user groups. This is a big part of how we can scope out ownership of different devices and user resources to individual roles. So with that, I'm going to dive in and show you how this works. So we're in administration. I'm going to go to security, and I'm going to go to administrative users. So I have an administrator, which is full admin security role. I've got a desktop admin and a server admin that have application administrator roles. And those roles have certain permissions. App administrators are pretty comprehensive. They can create apps, delete apps, they can deploy apps, that type of thing. So I'm going to go ahead and create a new user. And let's browse. This user is, we'll stick with the French thing. We'll do Louis. And add that. The next thing I need to do is add a role for Louis. So I'm going to go ahead and add, say, application administrator, application deployment manager, and we'll stick with that. So this person will be focused on apps, an app owner for the French subsidiary. The first thing I need to do is kind of remove what we add as the default. Default scope is assigned to every object, so we don't want Louis to have permission to every object, so I'm going to remove that. I also don't want Louis to have permissions to these two powerful built-in collections, so I'll remove all that stuff. Now I'm going to add a security scope to start with. And I have a security scope that I created called France. And I'll show how you could use that security scope and assign that to objects in just a moment. But I'll add that security scope. That will limit the types of objects that Louis can modify and mess around with. And then I'm going to add a collection. I'm going to add French users. And I think I'll add one more collection, which is devices. I think I have one in here for French systems. Okay. So what I've essentially done is I've said Louis has a couple roles, app administrator, app deployer, and is assigned to a very specific scope and two very specific collections. So go ahead and hit OK. Now where the scope comes into play, let me switch over quickly to the software library. I'll go to application management. I have a few apps in here, and I believe
prior to this demo, I added France as a security scope. Let's take a look. Set security scopes on PowerPoint. Maybe PowerPoint Viewer 2007 is only used very specifically in France, and that's what I want Louis to have access to. So yes, so the security scope is France. The rest of these applications, like the App V client, for example, is only set to the default scope. So you can see I've done that with the PowerPoint Viewer 2007. Now, if I, let me just go back in, double check everything's looking good. We've got now a new user, Louis, App Deployment Manager, App Administrator. It's got the scopes and the collections set. I can kind of get a quick view here of this administrator and their data. I'm going to go in now and let's see if I set this up. Let's go ahead and shut down the console. And I think I have a command, like a run as thing that I did here. Yes. So I'm going to run the console as Louis, and I should have a very limited set of things that I can see and do. So first off, in the assets, if I go to user collections, okay, I'm only going to see the French users. That's the only world I know. I'm Louis. And then for devices, I've got French systems, French devices. Once again, I could create collections that are limited to French systems and do some new things here. The next thing I'm going to do is look at the software library. Once again, I don't have scope for any of the package programs or any of the DCM or settings management baselines. Operating system deployment is not something that I have rights to do. I only see application management. When I go into the applications, I see the single application that's assigned to my scope, and all the rest is just unknown to me. Go to administration. I've got some things I can do that might be app-specific as an app deployer for some things around distribution points. But in essence, you can see that when I log in as Louis, I'm going to be limited. The show me for Louis is these basic roles and the basic scopes that are assigned to me, which is huge in being able to consolidate your infrastructure. All right. So doing pretty good on time. I want to finish off with some of the new things coming in SP1. So the first thing is we've implemented SQL compression, which is something that we were looking at as far as further enhancing our replication, monitoring, and controls. So basically, you can turn compression on or off using a checkbox. Hope you can see that. It simply says enable compression of SQL Server for this link. So you do it on a per link basis. As I mentioned, can be turned on or off. I saw some early testing numbers last week. They looked pretty good. Don't quote me on these numbers because we're still testing and still developing, but I saw a 50, 60, 70% improvement in the network traffic when you turn compression on, which was pretty significant. Like I said, that could change when we have maybe make some trade-offs with some quality and code and things like that, but those are some pretty positive numbers to see in some of the early testing. So when we compress the data, we send it over the network compressed, and we have a compression and uncompression, or decompression, I don't even know what you would say, at either end. Now you can imagine that that compressing the data does take some CPU processing. So you're going to incur a slight increase in CPU utilization. We're actually thinking, I grabbed this screenshot from an SP1 build where it's turned off. We're actually thinking that we would have it on by default because of the significant improvements we're seeing. But certainly you want to make a trade-off between the CPU utilization required to compress and decompress the data versus the network traffic you're going to save by compressing it. So that's something to consider in SP1. It'll be just a simple checkbox added to the UI. The next thing I want to talk about is distributed views, SQL, what we call D views. So think about D views as a way to turn replication off at the CAS. If you don't want to be sending and storing data to the CAS, you can actually turn it off by enabling D views. And it's actually shut down for that site data that I was talking about, not for all data. So for the site data coming from a primary to a CAS, which is hardware inventory, the software inventory, and metering data, you can actually, by enabling DViews, you can turn that off. What happens then is that at the CAS, when you retrieve data, site data from the primary site, like for example, you run a report, an inventory report,
or you look at a device and open up Resource Explorer, for example, to look at the detailed hardware inventory and software inventory for a device. What happens is it's an on-demand query to the site that owns that data, and it's returned. It only lives for that moment in time that you're using it, and then it's removed. Okay, so it saves on your data storage and your link traffic to the CAS. Now, I would suggest a reliable connection between the SQL servers, the primary site, and the CAS. Maybe they're both in the same data center on a very high-speed link, because obviously this on-demand query, it's not throttled or there's no controls. It simply retrieves data and brings it back in a big chunk. So that's something to consider when enabling DVUs. If you have a good connection between your CAS and one of your primaries, and you feel like, I just want to save on the data storage and the traffic over the network, go ahead and enable these DVUs. That's coming in SP1 as well. I mentioned at the very beginning that I had a customer that I advised them, hey, if you're ever going to expand someday, make sure you put a CAS up there. And in all the RTM documentation, the documentation for the CM12 that's out right now, you're going to see, hey, if you ever think you're going to expand or need extra primaries, go ahead and use a CAS. And I even advise my customer to do that. But now that I know, coming in SP1, that you'll be able to expand your hierarchy, I probably would have advised them differently, because they're small and they probably weren't going to need to expand between the time they deployed the CM12 RTM to the time they'll be deploying SP1. So by the time they need to expand at all, SP1 will be in place, they'll be upgraded and ready to go. So how hierarchy expansion works, it allows you to expand out your hierarchy when you need to for scale. We talked about that being now the primary reason you would do it. And so, to remove a site, you're saying? No, you can't. You can't do that. So it's expansion only.
Sure, you can. FDisk.
FDisk. Yeah, I suppose. But then the primary site wants a CAS there, and it gets a little bit messy. Bring Wally in as a consultant, but then call me later. Because you might need some of the developers for my team. No. So it's going to give you that freedom to expand out. I did a little graphic. I'll highlight for you. I'll run out of time. But so you add your CAS. We'll do that initialization from the primary site that you had in place. Then you can add your second primary, and that'll be initialized as well with global data. So the key is, I would say, stick with the standalone primary in RTM. And the reason you would do that is because I really don't want to introduce replication. I mean, it's a solid system, it's a good system, but if you don't need a hierarchy with the links and all that stuff, then don't do it. In the future, you'll be able to expand out. There's going to be some before and after work. I want to be clear with that. Just talking to some of my folks, it looks like you might have to remove some of the roles, like the asset intelligence role, from that primary and then add it to the CAS. Things of that nature. There'll be some documentation around it coming, but this is a pretty neat thing for being able to make it so you don't need to introduce a CAS and have a separate system sitting there just waiting to expand someday. You can do it on demand when you need to. So we talked about, in summary, Configuration Manager 2007 versus 2012. We got the scalability and data latency improvements, right? So your central administration site doesn't do any data processing. You've got good replication throughout your hierarchy. We've allowed you to consolidate your infrastructure. So you have less primaries, less secondaries. Use the collection-based settings, the role-based administration that Wally and I talked about to segment out your hierarchy and use the minimal amount of sites that you can. And then at remote offices, that big promise, removing secondary sites, using DPs that are enabled for bandwidth throttling and control. Here's a reference slide on the system requirements for your future viewing pleasure. And so in preparation for 2012, flatten that hierarchy, simplify, use branch cache as a way to minimize remote office infrastructure. If you're still using the old web reporting, the ASP.NET web reporting, if you didn't go to ConfigMan 2007 R2 and start using reporting services, that's the only reporting mechanism in CM12, so prepare for that. And we don't have mixed user and device collections, so if you have some of those in CM07, look to try to separate those out. We are running out of time. So blogs, how-tos, all that good stuff. Thank you so much for joining us this evening and sticking around with us. Appreciate your time.